Hi everyone, my name is Alejandro Marcu, and I'm originally from Argentina. I started programming games when I was 8 years old. So since then I've been programming as a job and for as a hobby. So yeah, I've been programming for 30 years now. The last 7 years, 7 years ago, I was hired by Facebook, so I moved to San Francisco to work in the headquarters. And I live now in San Francisco. What I want to talk about today is give you some tips that hopefully can help you advance to the next level and become a better engineer. Before going into the specific tips, I want to make a point, and is that it's very important to take charge of your career. Maybe you're in a company that really helps you grow, that they teach you things and you learn a lot, but in any case, you always must know where you want to go and keep improving, keep learning. Don't leave that to the company you are working for. So, tip number one, small steps. I used to think that I was impatient because I will write just a little bit of code and then test it. I was kind of ashamed, as if I was lacking some confidence to write a lot of code and then test it. But then I had the awesome opportunity to work with a mentor at Facebook. And the mentor was Ken Beck, who created Extreme Programming. He now works at Facebook, mentoring people and doing other engineering work. And to my surprise, Ken encouraged me to test even more often. He showed me his environment, and he had it set it up such that every time he saved a file, the test will run. So with this, I understood that it's not wrong to test often. Actually, what happens is that if you write a lot of code and then you test it and something fails, then it's hard to figure out where the problem is. You will spend a lot of time debugging and maybe a lot of time fixing it. But if you just wrote a little bit of code and you test it and it fails, you know exactly where the problem is. You may think that this doesn't always apply. And one case is when you need to do a complex big refactor. In that case, sometimes it seems that the most straightforward way to do it is to just do all the refactor, right? To go from here to here, and probably you are not even able to run the code in the middle. So you just go from the beginning to the end, and when you finish, you test it and you fix anything that needs to be fixed. The problem with this approach is that usually by the end, you will have a lot of errors and it will take a lot of time to fix everything. So in this case, I encourage you to use a way that seems to be more work, because you will need to create some adapters or maybe duplicate some code or think a little bit more in order to be able to reach intermediate steps. In each one of those intermediate steps, you will be able to run your code and test it. So this seems to be more work, but actually what happens is that every time that you can test it, since you did a smaller change, it's easier to test it and to fix whatever needs to be fixed. Another advantage of this is that instead of sending the huge code refactor for review, you will be sending smaller pieces. And this is much better, because when you send a lot of code for review, it's really hard for the reviewers to do a good job, to understand it deeply, and the iterations take longer, and it is very slow, right? But instead, if you just write less code, it's much easier for the reviewer to do a good job, and you iterate more quickly. Remember to work in small steps, and you will work smarter. Second tip is pair programming. The idea of pair programming is that two people will get together to work on a problem with just one computer. You may do it online, but I strongly suggest to do it in person if you can. One will be with the computer, and you can switch whenever it feels natural to you. You can be solving a problem that is difficult, something that you're stuck, or whatever comes to mind. But the important thing is that you need to communicate a lot. You need to kind of think out loud so that you can build on each other's ideas. And while pair programming is great to work on a complicated problem when you're stuck, it's also a great tool for improving because you get to see the thought process of the other person, not just the final result, right? If you read the code in a code review, you are just seeing the final result. But if you do pair programming, you actually get to see the thought process. So I suggest you to try pair programming with a friend or coworker. Tip number three, testing is a core part of developing. So let's say that you're working on a project and you find some code that can be easily improved. Are you going to improve it? Or will you think, I'd rather not touch it because I may break something? Of course, we want to be in the first situation, right? We want to be able to continuously improve our code to use the latest and greatest features and move with confidence. What do we need to get there? What we need is to have excellent test coverage. We need to be confident that if the test pass, the code is working well. You will need to work on the code and test together. Some people think that since they are under a tight deadline or they're in a rush, it will be better to just work on the code, and once the deadline is over, you will do the test. But actually, that's not a good idea. First, because you will end up testing the code manually, which is very time consuming, and you may introduce bugs because you get tired of testing and you start skipping testing or not testing it thoroughly. So work on the code and test together. And one of the reasons sometimes we don't want to write tests is that it seems so complicated that we need to write so much boilerplate and set up so many things, and it's like, okay, I want to test just this thing and I have to write so much boilerplate for it. If that's the case, think if you can write some testing infrastructure that will make it easier for your project to test. It can be a little bit counterintuitive, right? Like you are under a deadline and instead of working on what seems to be the most important thing, you are investing time in developing testing infrastructure to write tests, to write the code. But it works. Let me give you a personal example. My worst project at Facebook was one where I had to work on an unfamiliar code base. So it was just a short modification. So I did my change, I tested as well as I could. And sure, after a few days, someone tracked a production bug to my code. And it seemed completely unrelated. I would have never thought of testing that. It was like completely different. By contrast, my favorite project was one where we started from scratch, and we put a lot of emphasis in writing very good tests. We even ran into that, like at the beginning, each test took a lot of effort to write. So we started to think, how could we improve our testing infrastructure? And we created a framework that was specific to our project that made it so much easier to do tests that we were very happy to just, like, with two or three lines, we could just test our new feature. And it was really a pleasure to work with in that project. Everything seemed to flow, and I was happy working on that, and I was moving fast. So remember that testing is a core part of developing. Tip number four, done is better than perfect. Who thinks he's a little bit of a perfectionist here? Okay, many people. So you can view perfectionism as a gift, because you have high standards. You care about quality. You want to do the best. But often, perfectionism will get in the way of getting things done. It may prevent you from even getting started with a project because you think that you need to study a lot, learn a lot, before even starting. Or it may prevent you from finishing because there are always things that can be improved. And you should be able to limit your effort when the additional time spent is not providing enough value, and you could be using your time for better things. So one way to deal with this is using deadlines. For example, you may say, I'm going to take this week to study as much as I want, and next week I will start working on my project. Or you may set a deadline and say, like, I'm going to take 3 days to polish my project, and then it's finished. This doesn't always work. It seems that it should be very easy, but it doesn't. So another powerful technique is to be aware of your thoughts and feelings and try to reframe your thoughts. Because what happens is that sometimes there's fear hidden. To give you an example, when I was working for Facebook, I had a project that I wanted to open source, and I couldn't get to finish it. I tried to put a deadline, but I just couldn't, right? It sounds weird, but I couldn't. So I started working with this and trying to do some introspection to see what was going on inside of me. And I noticed that I was afraid. The project was going to be published on the Facebook engineering blog, so it will quickly get many eyes. And I was afraid that people will find bugs, will criticize it, will find it useless, or whatever it was. And I noticed that I was afraid that if that happened, it will mean that I'm a failure, that nothing else that I did will matter, and like I was completely useless if that was the case. So I started reframing my thoughts. And first, I tried to be a little bit more realistic about the project, and I knew that it was used internally, that it was well tested, that the code quality was the best that I could do. So by my standards, it was not a disaster by any means, the project. But even if externally the project was a disaster, that wouldn't mean that I was a failure, right? It was just like successful people fail a lot, right? And it wouldn't destroy my career. So once I started playing with this idea, like even if everything goes wrong, they are not going to fire me, I'm not going to be publicly shamed, no one is going to die. Once I started playing with this, it's like, okay, I think it's going to go well, but even if it doesn't, it's not a big deal. And once I did that, I was able to relax a lot, and my fear vanished, and I was able to quickly finish it and open source the project. So remember that done is better than perfect, and this is so important to keep you moving that we have posters like that hanging everywhere at Facebook. Tip number five, practice. So we spend a lot of time programming towards an objective, right? Usually we have a project at work or a hobby, and we're programming for that project. If we were tennis players, it will be kind of playing against opponents all the time. But tennis players actually do a lot of other things. You can imagine that they practice serving, they practice playing on the net, playing against the wall, and so on. And we as programmers, we tend not to practice much. We tend to just do our work. One way that I found for practicing that I really like, and I encourage you to try, is coding competitions. In a coding competition, you have a fixed amount of time to solve one or more coding problems. And there are a few reasons why I think that coding competitions are great. First, it trains you to work under time pressure. And to be honest, it's not the most important things, but when you are in the situation where production is down and every minute is costing thousands of dollars to the company you work for, that skill is very well appreciated. You're able to compare solutions with some of the best people in the world. And of course, you can use this to learn and improve. Many companies use this kind of exercises in their hiring process. So if you practice coding competitions, you greatly increase your chances of getting hired. And this is actually how I got hired to work for Facebook. Coding competitions will train you to think of corner cases. And this is really, really valuable, whatever software you're writing. So there are many sites for coding competitions. If you are looking for a place to start, one that I like is HackerRank, because it's very easy to understand, very easy to sign up and to start participating. It has some practice problems, and the first one are really, really easy, like adding two numbers, adding the numbers in an array, and it gets increasingly more difficult. So maybe you are thinking, well, but I will need to study algorithms, I will need to prepare a lot and to do a lot of practice and to check all the different sites and which one is the best and which kind of competition. If that's coming up, it's a perfectionist, right? So use this opportunity to deal with your perfectionism and go ahead and just compete. because even if you come out last in the competition, no one really cares, and no one needs to even know that it was you. So remember to practice, and if you are looking for a way to practice, coding competitions, I think it's a great way to start. And tip number six, keep learning. So I strongly suggest you to keep learning outside of your day job. As I said at the beginning, I think that it's very important to take care of your learning. So try to learn something different. If you are all day programming in PHP, don't just learn a new PHP framework. Get out of your comfort zone. You may choose to go very deep into a subject, or you may choose to just pick a little bit of different technologies. And what I really like about that is how quickly you get from not knowing anything at all to having at least some basic knowledge. For example, I'm interested in virtual reality, and recently I did a tutorial on Unity, and in just 2 hours I went from not having ever used Unity to being able to do a very simple game. And then in 1 more hour I used Unity to do a very simple virtual reality kind of Hello World example. So see what spikes your interest. There are a lot of different things happening. Some things that are interesting for me are machine learning, virtual reality, functional programming, Raspberry Pi, Amazon Web Services, and so on. See what spikes your interest and give it a shot. Don't think so much of whether this is going to a technology that is going to be used or if you can get a job or so on. Just follow your passion. Remember why you choose this career, because hopefully you choose this career because you're passionate about writing software and creating things. So remember your passion and have fun. Thank you very much.